New guidelines now recommend mammogram screenings every other year starting at age 40, 10 years earlier than the last recommendation. This comes from the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, an independent national panel of doctors, as rates of breast cancer begin to rise among younger women and people assigned female at birth. The vice chair of the task force, Dr. John Wong from Tufts, joins me now, as does Dr. Michelle Specht, a breast surgical oncologist at Mass General Brigham and the co-director of MGH's Avon Comprehensive Breast Evaluation Center. Dr. Wong, Dr. Specht, thank you so much for being here. We mentioned at the top the change is a decade earlier that mammograms should start. What prompted this new recommendation? Dr. Wong, I'll go to you first.
Thanks so much. The key piece of the latest science shows that more women have been getting breast cancer in their 40s. And so it makes complete sense that starting screening earlier at age 40 would help women live longer and healthier lives. And I'll just make one correction. Our prior recommendation in 2016 did recommend that women could start screening in their 40s. But at that time, there was a closer balance of benefit and harms. The number of women developing breast cancer in their 40s was lower. And so we encouraged women to have a discussion with their trusted healthcare professional about whether screening starting in their 40s would be appropriate for them. But now with this new evidence, it's pretty clear that all women should start screening every other year at age 40.
Thank you so much for that clarification. Dr. Specht, what does it mean for a woman to be one who is at average risk for breast cancer?
It's a great question. Normally, we think of average risk as someone who has a lifetime risk based on many different models that a woman's physician, whether they be their PCP or gynecologist, could use to estimate their risk. And these models include factors such as family history of breast cancer and certain types of exposures to various hormones, meaning how many children they have, when they got their period for their first time, whether they take hormone replacement therapy. And these models are something that physicians can use in their office to be able to evaluate a woman's risk. Again, if their lifetime risk is less than 20%, then the U.S. Health and Preventive Task Force recommends yearly mammograms starting at 40 every other year, not yearly, every other year. If someone's at elevated risk, and that could be between 15 and 20%, you could consider going yearly. And if they were at an elevated risk greater than 20%, then the American Cancer Society, American College of Radiologists tells us that we should add supplemental screening to that mammogram. So continue with your yearly mammogram, but add something like a breast MRI to that screening to help detect cancers that mammography may miss.
This question goes to either of you who can answer. I started to read a little bit, and it seemed like breast density had something to do with risk. And then I read maybe people think that if your breasts are smaller, then you're at higher risk and you may be more dense. But then I also read that that might not be true. But I have two doctors with me now, so tell me about breast density and risk.
I'd be happy to give the task force perspective on that, and I'm sure Dr. Speck would agree. Having dense breasts increases your risk for developing breast cancer. It also suggests that breast mammography may not work as well for these women. I will say that it still works, just not as well. And from the task force perspective, when we looked at the balance of benefits and harms of additional, say, MRI screening after a normal mammogram or ultrasound screening after a normal mammogram, unfortunately, we could not find enough evidence to say whether or not that follow-up additional screen after a mammogram would provide sufficient benefit or harm. And so we call that an I statement. We desperately want to have the evidence to help inform women whether or not a supplemental screening following a normal mammogram would provide them benefit. Now, having said that, it's frustrating to know that we don't have the evidence and we are crying for it. While we're waiting for that, we would encourage women who have dense breasts to have a conversation with their trusted healthcare professional and together make the decision that's right for them.
And Dr. Speck, following up on that, what's the way to know whether or not you're a woman with dense breasts?
Well, fortunately, in the state of Massachusetts and soon to be across the whole country, all women who get a mammogram will receive a letter that gives them the results of the mammogram, but also comments on their breast density. Breast density is a scale that goes from 1, not dense, and that includes mostly fatty breasts, to 4, extremely dense, and that's where most of the tissue is still breast tissue. We consider those that fall into category 3 and 4 dense, and those that are 1 and 2 not dense. And so centers like ours at Mass General, the Avon Breast Center, will evaluate patients who have dense breasts and will plug in their numbers to the breast cancer risk assessment model. And we can include their breast density to help determine their risk of getting a breast cancer in their future as part of this model, and then help guide their decisions about supplemental screening.
And for folks who might be concerned that starting earlier and having the mammogram procedure more often means more radiation exposure, how do we know that this is safe for women to start doing earlier and more regularly?
So the task force actually looked at this question, and we used simulation computer modeling to say, estimating the amount of radiation a woman gets from breast mammograms and the potential development of breast cancer related to that exposure. And we find that that risk for developing breast cancer from the radiation is small relative to the potential benefit. So it's clearly beneficial to have that screening mammogram to help women live longer, healthier lives. And again, if radiation is the concern, that should be a small piece of the decision.
I think I read it's about the same amount of radiation a person would expect to get from natural background exposure over 7 weeks. Does that sound right?
That sounds correct. Our newer imaging modalities using digital tomography is actually radiation that's less than it was traditionally when we used analog type of mammography. And even in the day when we had randomized controlled trials, which were performed, demonstrated an overall survival advantage to those women who were getting mammography. And so that did include the risks associated with radiation.
Switching gears a little bit now, we know from various research reports that while incident rates among Black and white women are close, the mortality rates are a bit different, with Black women having a higher death rate from cancer, and the factors that contribute to that are many. How might getting mammograms more often help to close that mortality gap? Dr. Wong?
You know, I'll say the task force is well aware of that, And we care deeply about this health disparity because we want all women to live longer, healthier lives. So we're well aware that Black women are 40% more likely to die from breast cancer than white women. Helping women get a first mammogram starting at age 40 every other year who are Black is a great first step, but it's not nearly enough to reduce the disparity. So we are desperately, urgently calling for more research to help us understand the cause of that disparity. We know that Black women get screened just as often, if not sometimes more often than white women, and yet we have this disparity in health outcomes. So we're calling for more research to help us understand why that might be. In the meantime, we're calling for effective, timely, and equitable follow-up after an abnormal screening mammogram. And if a woman should be diagnosed with breast cancer, making sure they have high-quality treatment for their breast cancer, working with their trusted healthcare professional to ensure that that is equitable, timely, appropriate, and effective.
And this next question is for both of you. Dr. Specht, I'll go to you first. I'm going to get a little personal here. My last thing is just about healthcare access. I had a little situation where I thought something was wrong with my heart around the time of Thanksgiving. I went to a local emergency room. Everything was fine. But afterwards, I did want to establish a relationship with the PCP at that healthcare facility. And when I called to get myself an appointment, I was told I would have to wait a year before I could see a doctor. And then it was the same even when I looked around at other places. And intellectually, I knew that as a journalist, that preventative care is harder to come by just because of industry pressures, because of the pandemic. But now that I've experienced it, it's on my mind. And sometimes I'm just thinking, if it's hard for me as a person in a state with a world-class healthcare system to get a sort of standard appointment, I wonder, have we given any thought to what it means for the U.S. healthcare system that people who are trying to be proactive about their health seem to have a limited time with doctors now?
We're incredibly challenged with this. And I'll be perfectly honest, we're challenged right now with breast imagers. There's a huge workforce shortage, not only for PCPs, but people reading mammograms. The one thing that we know is the Affordable Care Act did tell us that all women, and it's always been 40 and older, can get a mammogram, so they can walk in to any facility and get a mammogram, and we serve them to get that mammogram, with or without, you know, it's ideal when they have a physicians treating them as a PCP or gynecologist, but I hope that that will not hinder our ability to screen these women 40 and older because of the lack of access to primary care doctors and gynecologists. We need to encourage our young students to go to medical school and encourage them to pursue careers in this preventative care because it's such an important area to provide optimum care for all patients in an equitable fashion.
Dr. Wong, I'm sure you agree. Have you anything to add?
You know, I'll just say, as a primary care internist, you're speaking to the, for me, heart of the matter. For the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, we all have experience and expertise in primary care and access to helping people stay healthy, live longer lives is the primary mission of the task force. And for example, we know during the pandemic, many women may have put off getting a breast mammogram. And I'll say, breast mammograms work. And if you haven't been screened in the past 2 years, go ahead and contact your primary care clinician and make an appointment for a mammogram would be my appeal.
Both of the doctor's words, Dr. John Wong, Dr. Michelle Specht, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.